Okay, so continuing on what we have been discussing last time, before the midterm, we were basically discussing all the components of the transmitter, taking into account that our channel is an additive wild Gaussian noise channel, right? The components, the major components that we started discussing last time of the transmitter were number one, right? On the sampling side, so basically on the side of converting analog to digital, we have our analog signal, right? Okay. And we said that this analog signal is taken through sampling, right? Then it goes through quantization. Then it goes through PCM encoding, right? And at this stage, we have a digital signal, right? So up to this point, and then we start having a digital signal, right? So this is analog to digital conversion, right? Then starting from here, we start dealing with bits. Then we focused on the modulation part, right? So basically, I have those bits. All I need to do is to convert them into symbols, right? So this is modulation, digital modulation, and sometimes we call this a mapper, right? Mapping. So we are performing a mapping from bits into symbols, right? So this is what we have at the output of digital modulation, and basically those symbols are complex symbols, right? So they are complex. Then we mentioned something about pulse shaping, right? And after that, we have the actual multiplication by a carrier, right? And we said we will skip that part. We don't talk about it. We only care about these things which are considered baseband part, right? We don't really talk about the multiplication by a carrier. That's an analog part that we don't consider. It's already included by the fact that we deal with those complex symbols, okay? Then after that, we said there is some kind of gain which controls our transmitted energy per symbol, right? So there is an ES gain, multiplier or a gain, so amplifier. This is an amplifier, which has, if you talk about amplitude gain, it's the root of ES, right? So the only part that we did not explore yet was the pulse shaping part, right? We did not really talk about this part yet. So now I will start talking about this part, the pulse shaping part, and then we will move on to receiver side after that, okay? That I will just show you the bigger picture in terms of transmitter and receiver, right? Again, the ones that we, the components that we focus on the transmitter and receiver, assuming that we have a noise affected channel. So our channel is only affected by noise, okay? So if we look at the baseband transmitter and receiver, again, when we look at the baseband part, we can also ignore the part about the sampling. So we are only talking about the transceiver part, assuming that our input signal is just bits, okay? So if I assume that my input signal is just bits, those bits are going to go through the mapper, which is the modulation, right? The modulation, or it's called digital modulator. Right? And then after that, they go through the pulse shaping, which is going to be composed, if you look at it, it's composed of two separate components inside it. We already studied part of it, we did not study the other part. So first one is that our signal is converted into pulse trains, right? Symbol trains, okay? And then after that, we multiply this by some function. We call it g of t,
right? And because it's in the transmitter side, we call it GT of T.
So G transmitter
or TX to differentiate that from the T inside. Okay.
So G TX of T is just some function, some time function, right?
All of these together are what we call a pulse shaper. هقول لك بس دلوقتي دي اكتر.
هشرح لك الكلام just a minute.
Okay. And then after that we go through the gain, the root of ES, right? And then you have your signal, right? Transmitted signal. So X of T. Okay. That's the transmitted signal. At the receiver side, now this goes through, this transmitted signal goes through additive white Gaussian noise channel. Right? So basically, some noise is added to it, and then it goes to, so you can think of it this way, that this transmitted signal is going wirelessly through this channel, and then we have the receiver side where we start doing the inverse of these operations. So we multiply by a pulse D shaper. We will understand when we go to the receiver what does this do. So GRX of T. And then we sample our signal again. So we convert that from analog to digital. Right? That's basically sampling. At a particular time with duration T, TS, our sampling duration. So that is, you can call it pulse D shaper or converting the pulse shaping operation and going back to symbols, right? So when we do this, we go back to symbols. Okay. And then those symbols are going through the D mapper, we call it detection. So the operation of demodulation, right, which is basically digital demodulation. Okay. And then after that, we go through bits. So we end up with bits.
The demodulator is different from the detection, sorry.
I'll just correct this part. Okay. So the detection is one thing and the demodulation is another thing. Because the detection just retrieves our original symbols again, so not even here. Okay. So let me make this one shorter as well. Okay. And then we have here detection. And then after that, we have the demodulation. So this is the demapper, which is digital demodulation. Okay. And our signal is coming through the channel to this point. And everything is moving in this direction. So we end up with bits eventually, and here everything is moving this direction, and we start with bits. Right?
I will describe those once we go to the receiver side description. We are still trying to do the pulse shaping part from the transmitter, and then we will be able to move to the receiver side. Okay. Now, if you remember, how did we present or represent our signal after pulse shaping? Yeah, and we wrote an expression for that. So we said our transmitted signal X of T looks like what? So X of T can be written as energy, yeah, first of all, energy per symbol multiplied by summation of
Okay, g of t minus n t. Okay. S of n, right? S of n. Right? And then S of n is multiplied by delta of t minus n t, right? So to give ourselves better space, let's make the font smaller. So g of t minus n t. Minus nt, right? Multiplied by s of n multiplied by delta of t minus nt, right?
These are the symbols coming out of the matter, right? And then they are multiplied by the pulse shape, right? Now the operation here, which says pulse train, is basically making sure that we get those. So instead of just having one pulse at time t, we have one pulse at time t, we have the other, the pulse repeated again at time t plus or t minus nt, repeated again at t minus t, t minus 2t, t minus 3t, and so on, right? So that's the idea of saying pulse train, okay? But basically, all of this in terms of implementation is one box, which is keep on generating the pulse over and over again, and then the signal is multiplied by that pulse, right? Okay.
So I'll just. Why? Okay. Cannot even delete. Okay. Good.
So now the question is, what are the conditions on that g of t, the pulse shape, okay? What are the conditions on that function? Now we already have studied one condition. Does anyone remember what was that condition? We already studied as part of what we did before, one condition on g of t. Does anyone remember? G of t as a function should be unit energy, right? So we already studied that. I will just move on. Okay. So we already know conditions. Conditions. On g of t, and now we are talking about the transmitter side, right? So gtx of t, right? From a transmitter point of view, right? What are the conditions imposed by the transmitter only? Okay. Number one, which is something that we already know, that the total energy of function g tx of t should be equal to 1, which means that the integral of g tx of t squared dt must be equal to 1, right? So that's number one condition, that the total energy of that pulse shape has to be equal to 1, and this is just a scaling. So no matter how you choose the shape of that signal, right, you just need to scale it to the level where the total energy under that curve or contained in that curve is going to be equal to 1. Okay, so that's one thing. The other thing is a bandwidth issue, number two. You can think of it, rather than a bandwidth issue, you can think of it as, actually there are two conditions. So number one, the bandwidth of
g tx of t must be equal approximately to one over the bit duration, right? So approximately one over t, the symbol duration, sorry, not bit duration, okay, because we are shaping symbols here, not bits. Okay, so approximately it will have a bandwidth equal to 1 over Ts. Again, the major reason that we are using pulse shaping is that if you leave the signal as impulse symbols, they will have a bandwidth equal to approximately infinity, right? Because an impulse is a very highly or quickly rising and then very quickly dropping pulse, right? And this will end up producing very high frequency, right? So the only reason, or the major reason, not the only, the major reason that we are using pulse shaping is to avoid that, and we avoid that by making sure that there is a smooth transition from low to high to low again, such that the bandwidth approximately, why we say approximately? Because you can never, anyways, gtx of t is time limited. So it will always have frequency extended to infinity, but it should be very low frequency, very low amplitude in the frequency, right? So, number two, the bandwidth is equal to 1 over Ts approximately. And number three, which is a very important parameter, is that it removes inter-symbol interference. Right. Removes inter-symbol interference. And this is called the Nyquist condition. What does this mean? Okay, and this is the most complicated one. So all the others are quite easy to understand. This one is a little bit more complicated, right? Basically, we cannot, on one point, make the bandwidth of the signal, okay, approximately equal to 1 over Ts, and then on the other point, saying that the signal will never have parts of it leaking into the next pulse. So look at this from a time domain perspective. So let me new page and let's look at this from a time domain perspective. Okay. Here is my pulse shaping signal. Assume that it looks like this. Okay, and just finishes at this time, starts at this time. Okay. If my pulse shape signal is confined within the time Ts, the symbol duration, right? If you convert that into frequency, you will find that for sure it will have a bandwidth greater than 1 over Ts. Okay? Not by a small amount, by actually a large amount. You will see that this, as long as you cut the signal immediately, you will see that in frequency domain, you will have something like this. So if this is 1 over Ts, you will have something like this. So you are extending beyond 1 over Ts and with a significant value for your signal. Okay? You are not really becoming very much attenuated at 1 over Ts, which means that your signal does not have the bandwidth that you are looking for. Okay? The only way to do this, yes?
Because it was cut?
Yes.
Because
no, what cut immediately means limit. That's what both of them means. But the fact that I say that it's cut at that point, it means that it is time limited, right? Otherwise, it should have extended even with low amplitude to a larger region, okay? So if I don't want my signal to be time limited exactly, I can extend it, but with very low amplitude, a little bit further, right? And that's what we are trying to do, okay? So if I stop it immediately at time Ts, right, I will end up with frequency, what they call tail leakage. I will end up with the signal in the frequency domain extended with high amplitude, higher than needed, in the further frequencies, in higher frequencies, right? So the only other way is to let my signal extend further. But then when I extend my signal further, okay, the inter-symbol interference will happen. What does inter-symbol interference mean? So assume now that I don't want this to happen. I don't want the extension and frequency to happen. So what I will be doing is, okay, to avoid leakage, in frequency, right? This part is what we call leakage. It has some high components outside the needed frequency range, right? So this part is what we call the leakage. And to avoid this kind of leakage, right? What we will do is to extend the signal in time domain. So now in the original system, this is one pulse. This is going to be the next one, right? This is the previous one. And they don't interfere together, right? Each one is finished at its own time. Now, if we extend beyond, it means that I will have this pulse, right, going further. And then the next pulse is going to start here, for example, but the first one did not finish. So the next pulse is going to be like this, right? And then previous pulse probably also did not finish before this one starts. And then I will have these parts, which are inter-symbol interferences, right? One symbol in time domain is still not equal to zero while the other symbol already started. Okay? So it sounds like the problem can never be solved, right? This operation is S or G. We are dealing with G. So this operation is G of T. Here I'm also talking about G of T. So I'm talking about the pulse shape, okay? And this part is called inter-symbol interference. Okay? So it sounds as if, okay, I try to solve the problem from a frequency domain perspective by making the bandwidth of the signal limited, I end up with inter-symbol interference in time domain, right? I try to solve the inter-symbol interference by making the signal time limited, I end up with frequency leakage. I end up with the signal bandwidth becoming much higher than needed. So how can I solve the problem? It sounds as if it's not solvable. It is, if I look at it a little bit more carefully. Okay? Now, instead of saying that the signal has to be equal to zero for the next pulse, right? So this is one pulse. This is the next one. And instead of saying at the duration of the next pulse, I need the signal to be equal to zero, I have to think what the receiver is actually interested in. Is the receiver interested in the whole duration of the pulse, or is the receiver interested only at the point where the pulse will be sampled? At the receiver, I'm receiving a full pulse, right? But then I'm converting it, as we saw the receiver block diagram, into symbols, right? Those symbols are going to be impulses. So I'm not going to deal with this whole thing. I'm going to pick only one point of it, right? So what really matters to me is that at the point at the receiver where I'm picking the value of the signal, there is no effect of the previous signal, right? So now, if I am a clever receiver, which part of this signal I will pick? I will pick the lower one or the upper one?
The lower one.
Why the upper one is lower one or upper one?
No, the upper one.
Right? Why this is better for me? Because I want to pick the maximum amplitude of the signal, right? Otherwise, I will pick a smaller value, which means noise will affect me more, right? So as a receiver, I'm not going to leave this whole pulse. I'm going to eventually sample one point of it. Which point is the best for me? The higher one, the highest, the peak one, right? So at the receiver, I will receive the pulse shape, the pulse signal, and this pulse, whether it's a one or a zero, going through the negative, and then I'm going to pick the point which corresponds to the peak and sample that, read that value, right? Take it as a sample of the whole pulse, okay? So at the receiver, I'm really interested in the peak points. But this is receiver sampling the pulse at peak
value to convert back to symbols, right? And then deal with the symbols through the demapper and so on, right? Okay. We choose the peak to maximize SNR, signal to noise ratio. So I'm maximizing the amplitude of my picked signal such that the signal to noise ratio is increased. When I maximize the amplitude, I maximize the power, which means I'm maximizing the signal power, which means the signal to noise ratio is going to be maximum, right? Okay? Now, if this is the case, if I only care about one point, then rather than saying this pulse shape should be equal to zero after a certain bit or after a certain duration, which is the symbol duration, I only need to say that this pulse shape has to be equal to zero at the peak of the next one, right? But not only the peak of the next one, but the peak of the one after, the peak of the one after, and so on, right? Similarly, this pulse shape, which follows the same rule, should be equal to zero here, should be equal to zero here, should be equal to zero there. In between, I don't care, can take any value, right? This way, I've gained two things. Number one, I have allowed my signal to extend in time, right? Because it can have values not equal to zero further into time, but I only care about the points where I'm going to do sampling, right? Allowing the signal to extend in time means that I have more control over its bandwidth. So that's one gain. The second gain is that I have eliminated inter-signal interference by putting the condition that my signal, my pulse shape, has to be equal to zero when I'm sampling the next pulse, at the point where I will sample the next or the previous pulse, right? Okay?
Can
yes.
Can we reconstruct the signal again?
Yeah? Any signal? Which signal?
G of T.
We don't need to reconstruct G of T. I don't care about it, yes? Actually, what I care about is the symbols, because these are the ones that are carrying my information, صح?
Yeah, but it's part of X of T. I need the receiver.
No. Okay, think of it this way. I took my bits, I converted them into symbols, which are, that's at the transmitter side, right? Which are the, just impulses, right? But then the problem, if I throw impulses into the channel, I will end up with a very big bandwidth, right? So in order to smooth things, I will take each one of those impulses, make it a pulse shape, a smoother pulse shape, right? Now at the receiver, where is my information? Not the pulse shape. It's something that I did for the channel. What I want is retrieving my symbols again, which are these red ones, right? These are my symbols, okay? So this is what I care about. I care about this symbol, which is going to be eventually demodulated and converted back to bits, right? So I don't really care about this. This is used to adapt to the channel, okay? Is that clear to everyone? Is it clear?
Tell the receiver to sample at the middle point.
That's a different story. That's the synchronization. We will talk about that later on. Okay? How to synchronize and figure out exactly at which point in time you have to sample. Okay? That's a different story. But now, assume that the receiver can do it, so the receiver is going to be sampling at the middle point. Okay? Don't forget that these middle points are separated by how much?
TS,
right? So once you know, once you sample at the correct location, the next one is going to be correct, the next one is going to be correct, and so on, right?
But the other ones, other than the first one, will still have some error because of the tail.
No.
We
said that I'm not going to use this shape. I'm going to make sure that this, for some reason or the other, is equal to zero here. But it can be equal to non-zero further, right? So I did not show you the optimal pulse shape yet. I was just trying to describe what are we interested in. I will show you now what can fit this criteria. Okay?
All
yes?
Our information is sent through only those pulses.
This whole thing does not contain any information for me. Right? Only its amplitude contains the information. And I picked to use the peak amplitude, right? Because it's the best for me. I can pick only from this whole thing, I can pick only one point, right?
And that point will include the magnitude, which includes my information. The pulse, the symbol level, right? That's what I care about, okay?
Doctor, we are making sure that at the peak point, if
tail is
removed, it's zero.
Yeah, but it's not.
The receiver or the transmitter side?
Not the transmitter. This is a design of a transmitter. Mm-hmm. The receiver is going to do what? Just pick those points. But the tail may be picked in value of this symbol, will not be affected by the pulse shape of the previous symbol. And at the point of the pulse shape, the value is zero.
It's
not
over
the channel.
It's not going
to take any other. Ah, there's no problem. مش فارق حاجة التيل طالما ما بيأثرش على السيمبلز اللي أنا بطلعها. طب ما أنا في الآخر أنا بطلع سيمبلز في الريسيفر. I will describe this further. Okay. So let me now show you a pulse shape that can fit this criteria. Okay. You remember something called sync function? How does the sync function look like? So sync of x or sync of t. It's a function of t. How does it look like? Okay, so it will have a peak here in the middle, then it will drop to zero. Right, go to negative, go back to zero, positive, zero, negative, zero, positive, zero, and so on, right? And similarly, on the other side. Right? Now, what was the first point where the sync function is going to hit the... Does anyone remember? I don't remember myself. I have it written somewhere here. Yes. So basically, if this is of one, so sync of t only, this point is going to be what? One. The next one?
Two.
One over two. One over two?
Two F, right?
Yeah. So the first one F, the second one is two F, so it's going to be two. Two, tamam? Next one, 3. Next one, 4. And so on, right? Okay? So, this is in time domain. This is not in frequency domain. Okay? So, I'm not talking about a sync in frequency domain. So, these are not f. These are time durations. Okay? So, 1t, if I use here omega, it's going to be 2 pi over omega, and then 4 pi over omega. Sorry, 3 pi over omega, 4 pi over omega, and so on. So multiples of the first one. Okay, but 2, 4, and so on. 2, 4, 6, and so on. Multiples of 2 pi over omega. Tamam? So I'm talking about time domain. So that's t, and this is the sync of t. Right? So if I look at this, what do I find? If I have my first pulse, right, shape is used, is using the sync. How the first pulse would look like? Sync function, right? So this. Right. Now what about the second pulse?
Sync function.
It's a sync function. Shifted by how much? Let me just, the x is here. Okay. So the second one is going to be, okay. So if I pick the first one, number one, okay, what's the bandwidth of this sync function?
It has an infinite time, so bandwidth.
It's limited in bandwidth. What's the Fourier transform of a sync?
A pulse?
A square, right? So in bandwidth, in frequency domain, it's actually band limited, right? And the bandwidth is dependent on this parameter. So if this parameter is called T, or let's call it TS, my symbol duration, right? So the bandwidth is going to be 1 over TS immediately, right? So this in frequency would look like this, and it will have a bandwidth equal to 1 over TS, right?
Mm-hmm.
If I pick my
same function to have a width here equal, sorry, to Ts over 2.
Right, and minus Ts over 2.
The whole width, this whole width should be Ts. Okay, so Ts over 2 minus Ts over 2. This will have a bandwidth 1 over Ts in the frequency domain.
So this is the simple
domain? The time domain, pulse shape. You got the idea? أنا عندي البلس دي طلع function. بطلع value من modulator أضربها في function. لما أضرب function في constant يحصل إيه؟ Function becomes scaled somehow. تمام؟ Again, this happens in the real part, the imaginary part. صح؟ So you end up with a complex symbol. تمام؟ So I end up with the first pulse, with the first symbol generating this pulse. The next symbol will be at which time? Instead of being at zero, it will be at TS. The next symbol will happen at TS. صح؟
فيبقى shifted بمسافة TS ويطلع شكله كده. صح؟ يس. صح؟ different scale. Yes, different scale. No problem.
It should be the same shape, but it might be different scale according to the level of the second symbol. صح؟ Now what happens at the peak of this one? What's the value of the previous one? Zero. At the peak of this one, what's the value of this one? Zero. صح؟ So neither this nor that interfere together. Not only that, think now of a third symbol.
How the third symbol would look like? It will be shifted again TS, so it will appear at this point, and the peak will happen here. Let's say it's a negative. So it looks like this, and it will have zero at this point, right? And then continuing, zero at the next one, zero at the next one, and so on. And it will have zero at this point, zero, 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 right?
So again, the next pulse, which is the blue one, will have a peak when both the previous ones are equal to zero. صح؟ When I'm going to sample this, all the previous ones will have a value equal to zero. At the sampling point, ما يهمنيش نعملها ولا بعدها. تمام؟ Similarly, this one, because it's a sync function, again, it will have a zero at the peak of this one. اللي المفروض actually عندي هنا، معلش سوري.
دقيقة واحدة. So this is not correctly drawn. Okay.
So again, this one is going to be zero here at the peak of the previous. It's going to be zero here at the peak of the previous, and zero here if there is another one, and so on. What's your question?
It should appear, it doesn't matter, shift, yes, but still the zeros will apply. It should be shifted one, yes, yes. Okay, so the next pulse should be actually shifted one more. Okay. It's not gonna be easy to fix, so I think I will redraw it. Next one should appear separated by a duration TS. So if this is TS over 2, this point, so the next one should appear here.
right? No. Sorry. Incorrect. This is TS, TS. Because the base of the the base of the sink function is always twice the width of any one of these. Tamam? And the width of any one of these is equal to one pulse duration. So it should be that this one is equal to two pulse duration. This finishes at the start of the next pulse. Right? And it starts at the start of the previous pulse. So the duration between these two is 2TS, not TS over 2.
So this is TS, this is minus. So the original drawing was correct, but the labeling was wrong. So this is actually TS, this is minus TS, this point. Tamam? And then the next one, the next point immediately is going to be 2TS, the next one is 3TS, and so on. Tamam?
اللي هما zeros. Okay? And this duration is 2TS, but the bandwidth of the signal is 1 over TS.
That's the correct way to do it. So yes, the drawing was correct, only the labeling. This point and this point are TS and minus TS. So the next one is going to be here. Okay. And the next one. مفروض تخلص عند TS اللي بعديها. صح, يبقى الدروينج برضو كان فيها غلطة. Yeah, so this one actually should go all the way to here. This, right? And then it will go through. Okay. And this one is going to be here, 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 and so on. Okay. The next one is going to be at this point. So it should cover from here to here. Two durations, and then okay.
Yeah, so each base is twice, but then each side loop after that is only 1TS, 1TS, 1TS.
برسمها لكم تاني. اوكي. اوكي. But I will try to actually draw this on MATLAB and put it for you because the hand drawing is not very clear. But this is the correct way. So the issue here or the idea here is that we were able using such a pulse shape to achieve the two objectives. What were the two objectives? Number one, each one of the pulses has a zero value at the next or the previous pulses, right? So this means that inter-symbol interference will not happen. Why? Because at the receiver, when I sample each one of them, I will have no effect of the other pulses, okay? The other one is that by choosing the width here of this pulse shape, right, we were able to control the bandwidth of the signal, okay, to be equal to 1 over TS. So I achieved the two important objectives. Now what remains is the first objective, which is basically making sure that the total energy is equal to 1, and you can always do this by scaling this to some level before multiplying it with the pulse, right? So any questions about pulse shaping from the transmitter side? Now we finished. Again, this does not mean that this is the only way to do pulse shaping. I just gave you an example. So keep in mind that what I talked here about, it's just an example of Nyquist pulse shape. Example of Nyquist pulse shape. Right? Which achieves, importantly, objective 2 and 3.
objective one can always be achieved. Okay.
So the sync function is a pulse shape, which is an of course there are practicality issues with the sync function. What's the practical issue with the sync function?
Do you think in real life you can produce a perfect sync function? And if you say no, why no? Yes, because it extends up to infinity, right? So it's not time limited and cannot happen in real life. I cannot keep the source generating the pulse infinitely, right? So yes, there are issues. Typically, if you want really to use this and it's not actually being used in practice, it's just an example of how you can achieve these criteria, typically you will truncate at one point. And once you truncate, you will still achieve all the other objectives except for the bandwidth. And instead of looking like this, if you do some truncation, your bandwidth would look something like this. Right? So it will not really be exactly cut at 1 over TS. It will have some leakages, but they can, if you don't stop very early, if you leave yourself a little bit of space, then you can achieve a bandwidth which is reasonably okay, even though it will have some leakage. Okay? But reality is, we use other shapes. One of the most common ones is something called raised cosine. Okay? I'm not going to mention how it looks like here, because you can look it up in the book. But practically, we use raised, just for you to know the name, cosine pulse shape. Okay? So practically, we use some pulse shape called the raised cosine. The whole objective of this is not to show you the sync function, is to show you what are the criteria for pulse shaping and how we were able to achieve these criteria from the transmitter point of view. Right? Three criteria: the normalized energy, energy equals to 1. The second criteria is that the bandwidth should be approximately equal to 1 over TS. And the third one is that we eliminate inter-symbol interference. Okay? Now, how are these achieved in reality? They don't use the sync function. The sync function is an example of a function that achieves these criteria, but not very practical. In practice, they use raised cosine. Now, the objective is that if you go later on in practice and you look over a book and you see a raised cosine function and you look at its shape and the function and so on, you would know why it looks like that. Because it needs to achieve the criteria. That's why they chose this function with that particular shape. Okay? So, by giving you the objectives that we need to achieve and an example how they were achieved, even though this is not a practical example, I just hope that you understand when you see the actual practical pulse shapes, you know why they look like that. Okay? So unfortunately, I don't think the time will allow us to do the receiver side, so I will leave that to next lecture. We'll stop here.